Hello, this is Aaron Becker, and welcome to Lecture 23, An Introduction to Robotics. This first lecture is going to look at breadth-first search, which is a technique for finding your path, because we're looking at this larger problem of path planning. Now, just some demos that we saw last time. Last time, we looked at this very cool video of the configuration space, and for a robot, which was a polygonal robot, that could move in the plane, and so it could rotate or move around. So please watch that. I also showed you this cool JavaScript animation where you can move a two-link robot arm and you can see the obstacle fields, what they look like. I've got one more demo that I'd like you to look at today. And this is neat because you can draw out the obstacles and see how they map to the configuration space. So let me switch over to that. And so here is your robot. You can move the robot around, and that's not going to change anything. They also let you change the size of the robot if you want. And again, as we move this around, you see the plus over here is showing its place in the configuration space, because this is a two-link robot with two revolutes, so it's just going to map into two angles, which is this torus shape. And so you'll see that it rotates and flips around the top. Or if I go around this way, it flips around in the other axis. It's a cool little demo here. What I like is that I can now draw some obstacles in here. And so if I draw a big obstacle here, it's a big obstacle. As long as you close it in, it creates this polygonal space here, but it doesn't map to polygon over here. And to get this shape in the C space, what you have to do is each cell, you say, well, would that cause my robot to be in conflict with that? And so you can see, boom, this spot here, these configurations here are the only ones which would cause some collisions. And you can see them all mapped out here. One of the interesting things is if I change my position of the robot in the workspace, that doesn't change my configuration space, but it does change where the obstacles are in the configuration space. Another cool thing that I wanted to show you is that the size of the obstacle in the workspace does not map to the size in the C space. So to prove this, I'm going to make a tiny little obstacle, little triangle here. It's going to be an enormous obstacle over here in the C space, at least enormous in that it covers a lot of area. I can move that even closer, and the closer I get, the larger that obstacle is in this space. Of course, if I take my big obstacle in here, I can also make an enormous obstacle in my configuration space. But that's it's fun that you can draw a bunch of obstacles in here and see what do they map to. There's overlaps. You can see how these things work out. I'm going to make something narrow that I can just reach into here. So I want the robot to just be able to get into here. And so you can see, now if we do this inverse kinematic, you say, you can pry out of here without hitting anything. You can go right along the boundary of these obstacles and scale along them. To get around them, it causes some fun. And one thing that would be fun is how could we measure our distances in here and do some path planning. So in this case, this 2D thing, we can actually explicitly represent the configuration space so we can actually find the total path here. So I want to show you how you can find the total path here. And to do that, I made another demo. And so here is that same robot arm. And what I am doing here is in this brown color is these obstacles. If I move around the obstacles a little bit, it'll regenerate right here. This is once you get in here, we're kind of stuck, so I'm going to make it just a little bit wider. Okay, and see, this is my configuration space, and what I am doing is I'm giving a queue initial and a queue final. So this is my queue initial, and if I can move this around. And then this gradient of color shows the distance to any other cell that's reachable. in this whole set. And then this bot here is showing my configuration. So this is my final configuration, my initial configuration. This green path is the fastest route between them. And so you can animate this, and my blue spot is showing I'm following this fastest route. And you can see as I do that, I'm following along this boundary of these obstacles pretty closely in order to get here. If I want to move this one over, let's say I want to move it over here. And so all these light areas are ways that are very close, and as the gradient gets darker and darker, that is farther and farther away from it. You know, I could bring this goal through here, and this is about as far as I can get away from it. And you can watch my path now. The shortest path to get from this starting goal is to follow this green path. So two questions that we're going to address today is, how do we get this gradient of costs? And how do we then find the shortest path here? And we're going to do that. We're going to use a technique called breadth-first search. And I've made a handout for you to work in. And I'm also going to put this online so you can play with it. There'll be a link in the notes. But this is, again, you see the toroidal assumption. We can jump across these. And then you know, the neat thing is that points that are very close in this configuration space may be very, very far away in the shortest path. Because I can't jump from here to here. I've got to go the long way around. So if I put this goal in here, I get a very long path, even though they're relatively close in the configuration space. And that's why we have to do this planning. They're also relatively close. If they're close in the configuration space, they're also close in the robot workspace. You can say this is my elbow up position. Come all the way in here. I've got my elbow down position. That's the only difference between these two, but it's a long path here. One other thing I'll point is if you want beautiful images and you've got more time, you can turn up your quality factor and you can get some excellent looking images over here, which allow you to get a very close path. All right, enough of that. Let's go into our lecture, because we want to know, how do we build these beautiful shapes? So the terminology that we're using, this configuration space, is this capital Q. It's an S1 cross S1 because both of these joints live in the unit circle. You cross product that and you get the unit torus. And last time we ate some donuts to prove that there was a difference between a torus and the sphere. But our goal for path planning is find a continuous path from some Q initial over here to Q final, where that entire path is in our phase space, it's continuous, and it doesn't bump into any obstacles. So, you know, here's that higher resolution of that same one. These are, you know, it's much prettier, but it's a little bit slower to generate.